박수가 나오고 있는데요.
정조현 선수 크나큰 실수로 경기 그르칠 뻔했습니다.
네, 불공 좀 제거하려고 내려앉았다가 큰일 날 뻔했죠. 공동체 폭격 나와서
감감하기도 이른 거 아닌가요 지금?
자 이렇는데요. 네, 네 이렇습니다. 어?
불곰 상대로 국지방어기가 얼마나 좋은데 지금 정조현 선수 크나큰 실수 한번 했습니다.
네. 자, 순간 밝힌 돌격 모드로의 전환. 이것이 이제 어떠한 이유인지.
아 그건 그거네요. 그 국지방어기 단축키가 D입니다. 네. 그래서 D를 누르다 보고 실수로 돌격 모드에 눌린 그런 그림이었던 것 같고요.
자 그렇다면 이것은 김동원 선수에게 네. 기회입니다. 그렇죠. 자, 티브라만 파고 들어가면서 전체
그냥 둘로 제거 가능해요. 둘로 제거 가능하고 추가적으로 올 필요 없이 조이기 라인 탄탄히 해야 돼요. 조이기 라인 뚫려요. 뚫려요. 뚫려요.
자,
조이기 라인 탄탄히 해야 돼요.
자, 김동원 한 걸음 전진, 한 걸음 전진.
아, 지금 해병 셋으로 유도해서 조이기 라인 뚫어냈습니다. 지금 김동원 선수가.
네, 김동원 선수가 슬슬 숨도 이태고 있습니다. 출발은 정조현 선수의 실수였다 할지라도 그것을 자신의 것으로 완전히 가져올 수 있는 건 김동원 선수의 능력이거든요.
정조현 선수 실수 많아요. 자주 실수 많습니다. 정조현 네. 선수
자 포지셔닝만 좋은 자리만 구축할 수 있다면 그래도 반반이에요. 지금 반반.
네.
아 여기서 또 김동원 선수 손동 살짝 트이면서 본인의 땅은 수복하는 데 성공을 했습니다.
자 다윤이 업그레이드 정도 한번 체크해볼까요? 이렇게 되면 이쪽 1방 1업의 김동원 동일업의
네. 1업 차이, 방어력이 1단계의 차이가 나고 있고요.
네, 하지만 뭐 정조현 선수도 이제 공항연구소를 추가했는지 업그레이드 두 개를 동시에 돌려주는 모습이 지금 화면에 바뀌고 있고요. 네.
지금 이제 자원적인 여유가 슬슬 생기는 데죠. 184를 넘어서면서 이제 200을 바라보고 있는 정조현과
여기도 정조현 선수 반응됩니다. 자, 정조현 선수가 지금 아마 전투 순양함을 생각을 하고 있는 것 같거든요. 예, 이번에 패치로 인해서 전투 승량 이동속도 상향이 되었죠.
네.
그렇죠. 그리고 이제 바이킹이 자신이 압도적인 우위에 있다면 바이킹 말고는 사실 전투 승량을 잡을 유닛이 크게 없다라는 측면을 나온 것 같습니다.
그렇습니다. 무차 자원이 바탕이 된다면
네.
자, 패치 이후에 더 효율적인 전투를 펼칠 수가 있다면 얼마 전에 그때와는 다를 수가 있어요.
그렇죠. 하지만 지금 전투 승량을 뽑기 위해서는 일단 인구수를 조금 줄여야 돼요. 한 둘, 셋 정도, 아니 서너 정도는 일단 뽑을 수 있는 인구수긴 한데
네.
그것을 아끼고 인구수를 아꼈다가 한 방에 돌파당하면 그때 네. 위기거든요.
그렇죠.
자 그리고 슬슬 장기전을 위한 공사, 미사일 포탑을 공사하고 있는 김동원 선수가 3시 쪽을 자신이 못 먹더라도 아웃
올라갑니다. 올라갈 준비하고 있어요.
정조현 선수에게 공백기일 수가 있거든요.
그렇죠.
해병 부빙했죠. 이건 바이킹 내려앉아야 되겠는데요.
네,
자, 대기로 버티고 있는.
아이고 위험해요. 네. 지금 공동주차 숫자 얼마 안 돼요.
늘렸습니다. 전투 순양함 늘렸습니다.
일단 김동원 선수도 해병 비중이 너무 낮기 때문에
네.
뭐 전투 순양함 뜨기만 한다면 네, 이길 수 있는 쪽이
그렇죠.
정조현 선수긴 한데
네. 끌려가요. 근데 지금 끌려가요.
분명히 지금 공백기거든요,
정조현. 그렇죠.
분명히.
자, 일단 공성한 차로 시간을 벌고 있는
김동원 선수 일단 또 어찌 뚫릴 것 같으니까 계속 가고 있는데 이게 정조현 선수 이 타이밍만 버티면 됩니다.
네.
정조현 선수 이 타이밍에서 전투 순양함 둘 셋만 나오면은
그렇죠.
확 밀 수 있는 상황이에요.
뜨기만 하면 돼요. 정말 뜨기만 하면 전투 순양의 힘으로 조이기란 유지할 수 있고 상황이 일어날 수 있고요.
네, 생산키 눌러주시기 바랍니다.
몇 퍼센트 나왔나요? 80%, 90%?
네. 둘 정도는 지금 나오고 있는데요.
자, 두 개. 전투 시작하면 3키?
네.
드리겠습니다. 네. 달라진 전투 순양합니다.
네. 빨라보죠.
네. 툭 터지지 않는 스피드.
전투 순양함의 업그레이드까지 미리 신경을 써준 정조현 선수의 모습입니다.
그렇습니다. 준비하고 있었어요. 어차피 반반 싸움 시작하고 있었고
네.
확장형을 원했던 것은 정동현이고요.
그렇죠. 자 이렇게 되면은 전투 순양함을 이용해서 어떤 플레이를 해야 되냐면은
네.
기동성이 느린 공성교차를 혹은 미사일 포탑이 준비되지 않은 이 진영을 한 번에 밀어버리니까
네.
그 바이킹과 전투 순양함을 위쪽으로 쭉 돌려서 상대방의 생산시설 우주공항 쪽을 점령하는 플레이라면은 그게 네. 베스트거든요.
자 반대로 김동원 선수 입장에서는 지금 전투 순양함이 나오면 잡을 만한 유닛이 있습니까?
없죠. 없는데 지금 바이킹이라도 뽑으면서 해병 바이킹 조합으로 잡아야 되는데
네.
우주공항 숫자에서 밀리고 애초에 바이킹을 상대가 먼저 모아놨기 때문에 지금은 바이킹 누른다는 생각 자체를 발상 자체를 못하죠.
그렇습니다. 한번 힘으로 눌러보려고 했었던 김동원 선수의 진출은
결승
막혔고 대체 전투 순양함 떴습니다.
전투 순양함의 위험을 보여줄 수 있는 경기가 될 수 있습니다.
네. 200대 200이에요. 조합의 싸움입니다.
지금까지는 5명만 듣고 있던 유닛인데
네.
네, 공격력 업그레이드 제대로 되고 연사속도 어마어마하고 유닛 받쳐주고 야마토포로 공성전차 제거하기 시작하면
얼마 전
전투 순양함 약하지 않거든요.
얼마 전 됐습니까?
자 여기 이제 전투 순양함 동원되는데요.
첫 번째 저지선을 뚫고
자 이, 여기 여기 해병만 점수하면 돼.
그렇죠.
해병만 점수하면
해병 거의 다 죽었거든요.
고지감 전차는 순양함으로 마무리 되거든요.
전투 순양함
빌버스다 정경.
이것이 정경연의 관해실어 다닙니까?
네.
IM의 마지막 수정!
네.
정경연의 전투수장관입니다.
정경연 준비를 해야 됩니다. 공성전차랑 다 동원해서
네.
지금은 건설로부터 올라가야 돼요. 건설로 올라가서 수비하면서 준비를 해야 됩니다.
전투수장관이 네. 먼저 앞장을 서고요. 그 뒤는 바이킹이 어머하러 따라갑니다.
네, 이렇게 되면 이게 마치
아하.
네. 스타크래프트1의 배틀탱크와 같은 그런 위험을 발휘하는 조합이
있습니다. 그렇죠. 자, 일단 우주공항을 숨겨서 빨리빨리 건너해서 바이킹을 뽑고 판다까지 좋습니다.
네. 아, 빈동어
바이킹 숫자가 애초에 적어요. 빈집 가야 된다. 이거 빨리! 빨리 공성조차 빨리 빈집 가야 돼요.
그렇습니다. 전투순양함 상대로 가장 좋은 게 빈집인데
네네.
이번 패치, 오늘 있었던 패치로 전투순양함이 이동 속도가 상향됐기 때문에 이 빈집 의도를 정종현이 빠르게 파악하는
것 같고 알아요! 감지탑이 눈가기가 되고 있습니다. 정종현의 눈가기가 되고 있어요.
3킬을 하려면 평범한 승리로는 안 된다.
네.
기세를 완전 압도해야 된다는 생각이 정종현 선수의 전투순양함.
장기적으로 갔을 때 장기전으로 가면은 나의 전투순양함도 생각을 해봐야 된다는 것을 암시하고 있습니다.
그렇습니다.
아니 그것을 지금 스코어를 획득하려고 하고 있어요.
네, 지금 멀티 하나 정도는 사실 줘도 되거든요. 정종현 선수.
네.
지금 김동원 선수를 버텨야 될 것이 김동원 선수를 우주공항 지켜야 되고요. 불곰도 전투순양함 못 때리죠 지금은.
자 김동원 선수 지금 바이킹을 눌러주고 있어요.
네.
부랴부랴 지금.
네.
구속 건물을 달 여유도 없습니다.
그렇습니다.
일단 빨리 뽑아야 돼요.
바이킹 뽑는 게 일단 최선의 판단입니다. 일단 최선의 판단이고
네.
정종현 선수는 저 바이킹을 상대해주기 위해 지금부터는 전투순양함에 이 정도 쓰면 충분해요.
네.
정종현 선수도 받쳐줄 바이킹을 추가로 생겨내주기
그렇죠. 좋고요. 그리고
첫 번째 라인 네. 들어가 땀을 좀 빠졌어요.
네. 김동원 선수가 어떤 준비를 하고 있나 봐야 되는데 지금 결과적으로 전투순양함으로 민 건 없어요.
네.
조이기 라인만 저지했을 뿐이지 뚫어냈을 뿐이지 실제로 자원 타격이라든지 생산 건물 타격은 아직 쓰지 못한 상황. 지금부터 자원사가 많이 줘야 됩니다.
그렇습니다. 중앙을 뚫어낸 건 맷집 좋은 전투순양함이라면
네.
멀티를 타격하는 건 발빠른 해병이다.
그렇죠. 보병이 깃발 뽑아야 되는 거예요.
8기입니다. 8기요.
전투순양함과 보병 조합으로 거기다 여기 하지만 바이킹 아껴야 됩니다. 지금 바이킹 아껴야 돼요.
자.
전투순양함이 공대공이 강하긴 않습니다.
네. 야, 보세요.
오히려 많이 모았거든요. 여기도 바이킹 많이 모았거든요.
네, 하지만 이 정도 수로는 아직도 좀 불안해 보이고요.
8기의 전투순양함이거든요.
네.
바이킹도
아무리 카운터 유닛이라도 가격 차이가 있는데
네. 네,
수에서 압도하지 못하면
그렇죠.
바이킹으로 전투순양함 못 잡거든요.
그렇죠.
자, 김동원의 전투순 16기
네.
그리고 정종현 9기의
전투순양함 바이킹 정종현을 맞춰줘야 된다. 수비해야 되고
네.
바이킹 맞춰줘야 된다. 지금은
바이킹 맞춰줘야 돼요.
야마토!
세기를 막는 야마토인데요!
전투순양함이 안 느려요! 쫓아갑니다! 안 느려요!
야마토!
야마토!
이쁜다!
우주대 전쟁입니다!
Welcome back to Seoul, Korea, ladies and gentlemen. It is the GSL Team League. I am Doe, with me is Moltrap, and we are about to see these two teams face off. It is OGS versus StarTail, and I'm pretty excited about this matchup, Moltrap.
I think you might as well call it OMGS versus,
absolutely.
I can't come up with something.
Versus StarTail.
Anyway, there's the teams walking in. Bomber leading the charge. I believe that was the wind leading the charge for
MC OGS. Casually strutting with his hands in his pockets.
Back. Yep.
Yep.
He always seems kind of casual, MC. There's Nada.
Oh, it's pretty warm. He doesn't even need his coat. It's pretty exciting.
Actually,
exchanging the banner banners.
Very cool. Very somewhat shy guy. He was at times.
Yeah, he's a pretty shy guy. As far as pro gamers go, definitely. And so right now, both teams definitely going to be taking each other seriously. This is not like
yeah,
some
man.
Of the other matches that we've seen where one team seems to be clearly favored. This is one where they're both very evenly matched, and they both had their shares of ups and downs, you know, in terms of success of their players.
Yes, indeed.
Yep.
Yeah, man. I mean, yeah, exactly. It's like they've got so many players, like OGS, for instance. They've got MC, they've got Inca, They've got Nada, but right now none of those players are players that you could say are undefeatable, you know?
Yeah,
there's not one of those players that you wouldn't be not sure against, you know, Bomber or Jalizer. You know, it's hard to tell how any of those matchups would be affected. You know, it's not like in past seasons I might just say, oh, MC, of course he's going to win. But right now he's shown some weakness. We're going to look at the OGS roster, see who's on the bench, who could come out and play for the OGS team.
There is Cezanne, Genio, Nada. Everybody knows Nada. OGS top. Very good turn. OGS Supernova, another very good turn. OGS MC and Inca.
Ooh, boy.
Runner-up last season. And OGS Hero, we faced there. And there is OGS the win, coach of OGS. And really, any one of those guys could do really, really well.
Yeah.
OGS Hero is maybe the person we've seen the least of. But here's some stats on the team. They're in first place with GSL points. Look at all those players in the GSL. Wow, they have, let me count it out, 7 players in Code S, 2 in Code A.
That is ridiculous.
That is pretty impressive. Captain is Cezanne. And of course, the wind is the coach. And one of the few coaches in StarCraft 2 that actually still does pretty well in competitive play.
Yeah, man. And he just got dropped down to Code A, but he was doing decently, I would say, in Code S. You know, he stayed in for a couple seasons there.
Yeah.
So, definitely not a scrub exactly. I don't think with the selection of names in front of you, we're going to see the wins play today.
Yeah,
but, you know, definitely someone that could give a stand-up match to anyone on StarTail.
And now, interesting anecdote there. As you can see, OGS was actually formed before StarCraft 2 came out. Formed back during the beta.
Yeah. Oh, okay, back during the beta, yeah.
Yep.
Old generations StarCrafters formed by a lot of older generation StarCrafters.
Such
like Nada was one of the founding members.
Well, if I remember right, Supernova did have a Brood War career as well. He played a little bit. Let's take a look at their opponents. It's going to be StarTail. There's Rainbow, of course. And July Zerg, very aggressive Zerg player. Love watching him. Curious as well. SD Virus, great up-and-coming Terran player. And Bomber, the winner from Code A, defeating MVP. StarTail, Squirtle, and Ace.
1-3 from IEM.
That's right, and StarTail parting. And there's the coach, Mr. Juan. And I'm really curious about that new StarTail player that we saw there.
Yeah, interesting. Could be another one of those snipers.
Now they're in fourth place, 4 points. They do have 3 players in Code S, 1 in Code A right now. Rainbow is the captain, as
Jalizer, Virus, and Bomber.
Yep.
Bomber recently getting into Code S. Rainbow recently getting back down to Code A.
Oh, Bomber destroyed Code A.
He
just crushed everybody. Man. And, defeating
everyone's like,
MVP 4-2.
OMG, MMA is so good. Bomber's like, thumbs down.
Yep.
No.
Not going to worry
OMG,
about it.
OMG, MVP, best turn in the world. Bomber's like, 4-2. Whatever.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, if there's anyone on StarTail that could get the all kill, I would say right now it's Bomber. He's definitely on a streak that says he could win.
Yeah.
Squirtle in July, checking out the monitors there. Both of those guys, too, could do pretty well. Squirtle did get an all kill in the very first GSTL, if you remember. July Zerg is always a threatening player to go up against. He got 3 wins in the World Championship Team League.
Yeah, so let's find out
first
who they're going to send out first. Let's find out who says it first. And
that is
Hero.
Oh, the new guy. Yeah. Very interesting indeed. There's a couple OGS players that we don't really see a whole lot of. There's another player named Vines that we didn't even see on the roster who also plays for OGS. But we're going to take a look at Hero. Don't think he has a lot of previous GSL experience.
I am not finding anything on it at the moment.
Again, the GSL Team League, it's a great place to kind of show what you're made of. I mean, we've seen some players come up already this season. Yesterday we saw, of course, in the first match, a player that we had never seen before getting an all-kill.
Yeah.
Slayer's Taja.
Yeah, Slayer's Taja coming off the bench and saying, what, you never heard of me?
And
you heard of me now!
Yeah, that's right.
And there's Squirtle.
Did pretty well at the IEM World Championships back a little while ago, but since then hasn't had a whole lot of success in GSL. Got knocked out right away in Code A. So he's going to have to come back through Code B to get into Code A. Code B, of course, is another name for the Code A qualifiers. Sometimes you hear them referred to in different ways. But still a Protoss to keep an eye on. Definitely has a lot of potential, even if he hasn't shown it quite yet in the GSL. Lovely shot of our studio. These two guys are going to go head-to-head on Xel'Naga Caverns, always our first map for the GSL. The winner stays on. The losing team picks a new player to challenge the winner and gets to pick the map as well. We've got a great map pool to choose from. And the newest addition to that map pool is Belshire Beach, which is a smaller two-player map. I hope we get to see it, but we may not. We're going to find out. The game is starting right now. Squirtle. And Hero. Let's find out. All right. And here we go. Down in the bottom, representing OGS, is our red Protoss player. He is
OGS Hero.
OGS Hero. He'll be a hero if he gets an all kill.
Yep, and we are going to see a Protoss first Protoss here.
Yep. OGS fans. A lot of fans in the audience today. And here is our other player from the team, Star Tail, named after Pokemon. Used to be known as Go Boogie, but in English, that's
Star Tail Squirtle.
Right. Star Tail Squirtle.
So I finally tracked down Hero.
Yeah.
And as far as I can tell, he hasn't
been
in
the... Oh, look at this. Star Tail Squirtle, though.
Is that a proxy gate?
That is indeed a proxy gate.
All right, well,
a little bit of cheese.
Hold that thought. Anyway, Hero, really quick. He hasn't been in any Korean broadcasted games that I'm aware of, but he was in the FXO Invitational, and so he's played against a lot of foreigners, actually.
Yeah.
And did pretty well against most of the foreigners. Only played against the STC, as far as Koreans go, that I recognize.
Oh, yeah. OGS the STC?
OGS the STC. He beat him. But other than a couple pretty strong foreigners, back in November, he hasn't really played anyone too particularly of note. And there he knows what's going on.
Cancels it right away.
Gets the forge as quick as possible.
Yep. He knows
best thing he can
this.
Do in response to his proxy. Now, he might be expecting proxy two gates. And this is just one gate, so it might just be pressure into a more longer-term build. And he might be actually over-committing by getting all this, you know. Well, we'll see if he over-commits. The forge is good, but he gets too many cannons.
And here comes the
first
zealot,
like that.
Going to work immediately on the pylon for just a moment. If he can depower that gateway, that'd be pretty good. There is a zealot and a bunch of probes defending, though. Right now, Squirtle not really able to put a lot of pressure on Hero. And that cannon is in a great place, very hard to attack. Two zealots in now for Squirtle.
Yeah, and actually this is not going to do very much. All he has to do is dance around until that cannon warps in, and then he's going to be safe.
He needs to make something happen right now, and nothing's happening. That cannon, I don't know if it quite reached the mineral line.
Two zealots, a couple probes, and he's actually brought an extra probe in here. Another zealot coming as well, but the cannon is now warped in.
Yep.
And that is the end of this rush.
Yeah, it's going to be pretty tough. He's going to get a Cyber Core, try to get a couple Stalkers out right now. His Cybernetics Core is going to be coming out faster than Hero's, so we will have those Stalkers earlier. That's going to be very, very helpful. But again, you know, once two cannons get out, which the second one is on the way, it becomes very, very difficult for the person doing the rush to really, you know, make it work.
Actually, that is in fact a pylon.
Oh.
It's okay, though. Because that cannon's going to cover that pylon, and yeah, but like you were saying, I mean, just the one cannon, it has enough coverage that it doesn't really matter. He can use it, and he needs to fall back to that cannon, actually. He needs to fight within range of that cannon. He's got less zealots. Only loses some shields. Actually loses some health on those zealots, though.
Doing a good job of not losing them altogether, though.
Yeah, a little bit sloppy by Hero to let his health go down, because now the Stalker coming in here. And actually, that cannon cannot stop that Stalker from doing anything. And he's got four zealots against the three. So if he tries to engage the Stalker with the zealots, then
one taken down.
We will see Squirtle engage with his zealots. Oh, it might catch it.
Oh, needs to be careful. Second Stalker out for Squirtle right now. And this is another tense moment for Hero. He's going to need to micro very, very well. Third gate on the way.
Yes,
so the gate research about the same for both players.
He is persisting with this pressure here. And warp gate research is on the way for both players. It's actually closer for Squirtle. And he's got more units here. He's not able to fight within range of that cannon because of the stalkers. So he's actually losing ground.
Yeah, Squirtle picking off a couple stalkers. One, or a couple zealots rather. One stalker almost dying for Squirtle. OGS Hero, though, definitely taking the lead right now.
Oh, snipes that stalker to
yeah.
Blow health.
I don't think this is going to work for Squirtle. He needs a miracle right now to make this push successful.
Well, he's only been working off that one gateway.
Oh, actually. Wow.
He is going to power down the stalkers. It's 2-on-1 now. That one's going to die pretty quickly, but he's getting an extra hit. He's going to be forced to fall back. But warp gate research is almost finished. And he's got three more gateways warping in. He may just turn this into a four-gate push because he's already done enough damage.
He certainly could.
And there's only three gateways in the main for Hero.
Hero
there he goes.
Was not able to kill that pylon. That's actually very, very big for Squirtle. Another gateway going down for Hero. Right now, Squirtle will be on four gates soon. A lot faster than Hero will
be. Oh, he shouldn't have fallen back.
Squirtle trying to do some damage.
I mean, he had less units, but I think he should have tried to make use of the top of that ramp there, although he did fall back. Actually, it was a good move. He
yeah.
fell back and rejoined with those units. I didn't realize his warp gates were so close.
This is such a tense moment right now. I mean, if Squirtle can take this game, that'll give such huge momentum to StarTail. But Hero's holding so well.
Yeah, Hero's looking okay. Now, the thing is he has three warp gates to Squirtle's four. But, oh, he's going to unpower that warp gate. Squirtle seeds the low ground and falls back, and that is now actually, even though I said it a long time ago, the end of that rush.
Yeah.
and yeah, he's just left with three gateways back at home, and Squirtle forced to fall back and play a longer game, and he's just gonna probably expand, I think. He's got a lot of money in the bank.
Well, he put down a Twilight Council. He could definitely expand. I wonder if we're gonna see Blink Stalkers, though. I'm kind of curious.
Well, maybe he's not going to expand. He needs to do something. Either expand or make units. There he makes a couple zealots, but with only three warp gates, he can't actually spend all of his money that easily.
Yeah, absolutely. He'll need to have a bit of a trust fund, because he will be losing some units. But here comes Hero. He's going to send... I would imagine he wants to send the zealots up first. There we go.
Yeah, that would be a good idea. And he could actually...
safe, though.
Well, they got about even units, so he can't quite break the ramp at this point. Especially since the warpins are going to be a lot closer for Squirtle. And that probe spies that situation. Now that pylon actually does not reach the top of that ramp.
Yeah, that's another thing about the pylon radius being a little bit smaller.
I mean, it's obviously closer. He can warp in units on the ramp. And
he does
cancels
cancel
the pylon as a result.
Okay.
Interesting.
Oh, a dark shrine coming up for Squirtle, though. You can see it on the production queue.
This is a crazy
and
game.
And there is no Robo right now. Or never mind, there totally is a Robo.
There's no
Hero.
Robos other than that
except
one.
Except for that one, yeah.
But
other
man,
than that Robo, there are no Robos.
Only that single Robo.
Yeah.
He's got an Observer on the map, I believe, now.
And this is a good response by Hero, because a lot of times if a cheese like that is held off, a lot of times the Protoss player that did the cheesing will be tempted to try to get DTs just because if there is not a robotics bay, it's
a free win.
Yeah, it's basically an auto win because it's very, very difficult to defend. Now, there were cannons at the base too, so those, of course, can
that's
detect
true.
Squirtle expanding as well. So,
that's
we'll
true.
See if he can hold it.
I wonder if he remembered that there was cannons. There's a cannon in the main. Anyway, Observer comes in here. He's going to see it pretty quickly. Now, DTs are being warped in on the right side. And as if...
oh, there it is. He sees the Dark Shrine.
As if prescient. Hero did send his forces down there and is blocking those CTs
nice.
From getting in until he can get his Observer,
yep.
his second Observer out.
Fighting some time.
Which is almost done. Yeah, so those DTs are going to have to take the long way around, not going to accomplish anything. So, well, that's a lot of money, man.
Yeah.
Dark Shrine, a couple DTs. That is a ton of gas and minerals that have been pretty much useless.
Yep.
Now, at the same time, because he had that forge up early, plus one weapons is just about to finish for Hero. That's an interesting
yeah, well, that's also a very good thing.
Advantage.
As long as you have the forge already, you might as well get a fast plus one weapon. Oh, one stalker getting taken out. And right now, Squirtle, just kind of patrolling about the map, wants to get his expansion going. What's a worker count right now?
We are looking at almost even.
Pretty even.
Squirtle's up 34 to 32.
All right. So this could actually end up being a bit of a longer TV, yep. or a PvP rather. Both players not really into pressuring too hard at this point.
Yep. And Squirtle getting cannons as well, just in case, because he hasn't been able to scout at all. And you need those cannons yourself, just in case your opponent DT rushes. And in fact, he got a couple observers out and is switched over into a Twilight Council.
Yeah.
And is upgrading Blink. So Blink just starting to upgrade for Hero, whereas Squirtle has Blink fully upgraded now, and he's going to go out and do some harassment with his Stalkers, probably.
And I really do like that move by Hero, too, just because when you get the Robo like that, if it gets scouted, a lot of people would assume you might want to go, you know, one Vice Colossus or something like that. But if you just keep it for the observers, going Blink Stalkers is also really good, especially against someone who goes Robo.
Yeah, definitely. If they go for Colossus, you can always Blink in and go.
Yep, depending on the position. I mean, when you say something's good against it, that's always assuming that there's going to be good unit control, too.
Yeah. And I was going to say that's exactly what he needs to get done with these Blink Stalkers, but pretty soon Hero's going to have Blink as well, so it'll pretty much negate that. But you want to use that Blink to your advantage if you have it. Go in, take pot shots, Blink back, take pot shots, Blink back, and slowly whittle down the health on all of their units if you can. Especially if they're trying to turtle, but with Blink of his own, he could easily chase him with Blink if he really wanted to.
Right.
And at this point, he actually does have more Stalkers. Hero's 22 Stalkers to the 16 of Squirtle. So he is at a pretty big advantage there in the army count.
Yeah, Hero may just decide to push right now. He's moving up across the map. Looks like the armies might be blinking ahead to pick off the Stalker.
Yeah, so now it's his turn to harass with that run in Blink and jump back.
And there's the shield. Angle's not the best for Hero right now.
No, it's going to be hard to go through that choke.
Yeah. Yeah, your natural's so well protected against large armies just because you're able to get the nice concave at the choke like that. Robotics Bay going down for Hero, though, so he may decide to transition into Colossus a little bit. I think he's kind of waiting for Zealot Charge to finish right now. That's, of course, you can get your units right next to the Blink Stalkers and chase them just like Speedlings work against Blink Stalkers and ZVP. Charge lots work very well as well.
Yeah, and he's gotten out an Immortal as well.
Oh, he's going to blink up on the high ground. Oh, taking out the Pylon, going after the Cybernetics Core. That is actually huge.
He can't lose that core. Decent Blink Micro there, blinking back to hurt Stalkers. He has the high ground, but it doesn't really matter in this situation. It's more the formation.
Yeah.
And it's hard to get a concave there. Guardian Shield goes down. Massive blinking going on for both players. And he's eventually driven off. Just too much pressure from the high ground there.
This has turned into such an even game right now. The supply count nearly even. Both players well saturated on two bases. Neither one has really been able to do a lot of damage to each other. Depowering the Cybernetics Core for a while was very useful. But not a huge blow at this stage of the game.
Yeah, well, I mean, he wasn't upgrading anything out at the time.
Yeah.
So, but getting a pylon down obviously makes him spend another pylon. Both players tearing down rocks to try and take extra bases. Now, Squirtle tore down the rocks on the side to get that third on the left, whereas Hero is about to plant down his high yield.
Yeah.
So,
if you can hold that.
And he's getting a couple Colossus right now. Actually, wow, yeah, he has two Robos pumping out Colossus, whereas Templar Archives going up for...
Yeah, I think we might see... some Archives, yeah.
Huh.
Yep. Now, Archons...
That's interesting.
You could picture this. Picture Blink Stalker army with Archons backing it up. Zealots would be taken down by the Archons relatively quickly, which would allow your Stalkers to continue to blink, so possibly a theory that might work out.
Yeah. But, I mean, Archons... got a little bit longer range now. They are massive now, so you can't stop them with fourth fields.
Yep.
And he is indeed going to orphan a couple Archons there.
We're definitely in a new era of PvP where we're not going to see quite as many short games as we did before.
Yeah, and that's going to be pretty good.
Yep, there's a fight. And Squirtle blinking down. Is he going to be able to deny the gold?
The gold is almost up. It's almost too late to cancel. Blinking in, picking off a couple Stalkers. And the Colossus join up with the army, so they're now two Colossi. Now, the thing is he only has the one sentry. Just have some token guardian shields. But,
yep.
Yeah, things are so closely matched right now.
Yeah.
15 Zealots to 21. 5 Colossus to 4 Immortals. 22 Stalkers to 19 Stalkers. So almost even, but a little bit of an engagement here. He goes in. Colossus doing so much damage to that Zealot line. But he blinks in, trying to pick off those Colossus. Immortals doing tons of damage to the Stalkers in the back.
Wow.
Is he going to hold off, though? Archons.
Those Archons killed those Zealots so fast.
Oh, man. Wow, the Archons did a better job killing the Zealots than the Colossus did. And now he's on the run, forced to fall back. Archons doing so much damage, blinking on top of the Colossus and taking them out on both sides.
Immortals chasing down the Colossus as well. Archons and Immortals going after the probes and Colossi. Squirtle overextending maybe just a little bit, but so far doing very, very well in that engagement. He is slightly ahead on supply right now.
He has full shields on all three of those Immortals right now. Almost full shields, rather. So he's going to be able to soak up a lot of damage and take things out so quickly. Pylons going down. Probes attacking with Zealots. Colossi running for their lives, trying to do as much damage as possible from behind, but they cannot get away from the Blink Stalkers. And the Immortals coming in from the side. Those Colossus dodging so well, but they might just go down anyway.
Yeah, I think that gold base is going to be taken out right now. That's going to give Squirtle a huge, huge lead in this game right now. What was once a 2-supply lead about 30 seconds ago is now a 30-supply lead.
That was amazing.
Yeah, taking that gold is so, so risky in PvP.
I gotta hand it to Hero. He microed those Colossus like a champ, man. They were dancing around, staying alive, but it just was not enough. And like you said, it didn't really matter that they danced out of the way once those four Immortals started focusing that Nexus.
Yeah, well,
gold goes down, and now we have a double income deficit right now because he lost some probes there too. Squirtle is mining more than double what Hero is.
So right now Hero's trying to get that expansion up and running. He needs the economy desperately. Squirtle is doubling the money that that Hero's taking in right now. And a Dark Shrine for Hero coming out. Maybe able to do a little bit of harassment with it, but Squirtle does have
He does have a Robo. He's been pumping Immortals. He has one observer somewhere on the map.
Yep.
That'd be cool if you could click on the bar and see where it is. But it looks like Squirtle might not even let him get those DTs.
Forward pylon going down for Hero up in the upper left corner.
He's going to be able to kill.
DTs there. Yep. And here comes Squirtle moving in. Oh, the Immortals immediately owning one Colossus. Squirtle moving in with a bunch of Stalkers, Immortals, and a couple Zealots as well.
And get that Archon in there to crush those force fields so his troops get charged forward.
Wow.
And Immortals powering down on those Colossus. They fall back, but they take hits as they go. And they are almost obliterated. He actually was able to use those minerals to his advantage. But he's like, all right, you know what? I'll just make sure you don't get a third again while I warp in some more units.
Yeah, continuously denying the third. That is huge. Immortals getting a couple hits from the Zealots, but Squirtle running in with more reinforcements. This could be it.
Charge bots getting up next to those Colossi, giving them some space so the Immortals can come in and just, oh my god, they're just powering down those Colossi so quickly. The damage from those four Immortals. Templar warping into Archons. It is natural. I think we might have just seen the first Manor Archons.
Yeah, DTs though for Hero, cleaning up some of the armies for Squirtle, but here comes the Observer and the Archons.
There
take
we go.
It out. GG.
GG.
Wow,
Coming
Star-tale.
From the new player Hero, Star-tale takes an early 1-0 with Squirtle coming off.
He's all killed before. He could do it again.
Squirtle has all killed.
Squirtle has all killed. He got an all kill in the very first GSTL.
Ooh, that's right.
Yeah, that's right. I'm trying to remember what Genie 4 owed, but he did do it. And so Squirtle really showing us how Archons can be used in PvP now. I'm so glad he did that. Very cool.
That is pretty cool. And the Colossus, they're your traditional units. Like, go ahead and stand back and just roast lines of Zealots. But with the Stalkers targeting on the Colossus, they had to kind of fall back a little bit at different times. He was just able to send those Archons in. And with the three range, they could just reach right over the shoulders of the Zealots.
Yeah.
Kind of like, you know, you got your Spartan shield up, all of a sudden the spear comes out the side.
It's like a Stalker phalanx.
That's right.
Yep.
It's like a little phalanx there. And took out those Zealots a little bit faster than the Colossi.
Yeah.
And those Immortals, man, thum, 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 taking out Colossi. That's the sound they make.
I love
thum. It's a thum.
I love your Immortal impressions.
Thum, thum.
Well, anyway, I'm so happy that he built Archons, though, because that's the thing, is that PvP is going to change. This patch is going to change things for PvP. We're already seeing it in game one of OGS versus StarTale. And now you got to wonder, who is StarTale going to, or who is OGS, rather, going to send out next?
Yeah. Squirtle, and by the way, for those of you wondering, some people are like, hey, he had a Dark Shrine already. He can make Archons with the Dark Templar. Why would he make a high Templar Archives? Well, it's because the mineral and gas count is different.
Right, right.
For the High Templar and the Dark Templar. And so you're able to get out more with different amounts of minerals and gas for the different...
Yeah, exactly.
Using either High Templar or Dark Templar.
Both very expensive units, so you can kind of tailor that depending on what resources you have at that point in the game as well.
Yeah, exactly.
Yep, that's absolutely true. Not to mention that sometimes some players I've seen like to use Storms on, you know, a lot of Zealots, but in this case it wasn't really, you
Storms
know.
Are pretty bad against Protoss.
I've seen it. I'm not saying it's good. I'm just saying.
Yeah.
Just theorizing. Yeah.
Anyway, let's go ahead and see who is sent out next to face Mr. Squirtle. And it would be... Zenio coming out.
So sending out a Zerg player against a Protoss player, but he is quite the aggressive Zerg player. And aggressive Zergs have tended to be rewarded lately in the ZVP matchup. Squirtle may have his work cut out for him this time. And there's his results right now. He was in the Code S round of 32, but he did get knocked down to Code A,
and then knocked out again by Koka.
Although it is saying that he's going to be in Code S July. I don't know if that's... I thought he got knocked out.
No, he was eliminated by Koka in the first round of Code A.
Yep. Well,
maybe he's qualified for the Super Tournament. Maybe that's what that is supposed to indicate. But, in the GSTL February, he all killed Foyu, it looks like. By the way, Squirtle.
Oh, okay, that's right. That's who it was. So long ago. We're going to take a 2-minute break first. We'll be right back, guys.